Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard their point. Now, hear the counterpoint on Libertarian Counterpoint Podcasts.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. My name is Jason McPhee, and I will be your host today. And coming to you with me on this show will be, in the upper left corner, is Leon Brathwaite. He is a retired engineer from the state of California. And in the box below, you'll see Tim Everett. He's our a resident libertarian pilot, our screaming eagle of freedom. So, anyways, this is going to be a slightly different show this time. We are actually going to try looking at some reviews for different arts, movie, book content, stuff like that, to touch on issues that relate to libertarian values. And you know, because a lot of times there's things out there that people may not be aware of, that you know, they might be seeing something that really rings true with them, but they don't really know how to apply those values as far as their politics goes. And so we just wanted to kind of highlight some of those things going forward. Now, in this case, it's also to dispel some things where people might get the idea of certain values as being libertarian, and in this particular show, we're going to be focusing on that. And so at this point, what we're going to be looking at in a time when truth is stranger than fiction is what we're seeing. You know, we've had a few years of President Trump. We've had a virus that's led to a shutdown and kind of upended all of our lives. And that has led us to a show called The Tiger King. And it's literally a show about a guy who's a private zookeeper. He raises big cats, and he has a lot of strange things going on. But one of the things that's interesting, and he actually ran for governor as a libertarian. And so there's connections made in the show that tie him to the Libertarian Party. And so we wanted to examine some of that connection and see if it's really valid. But at this point, before we go any farther with it, we've all watched the show recently. And so we wanted to just give you a quick trailer of the show. You can still catch it on Netflix. It's out there. It's a highly viewed show at the moment. But here's the trailer.
It's not every day that a zookeeper went to prison for murder for hire.
There are more captive tigers in the U.S. than there are in the wild throughout the world.
Animal people are nuts, man. They're all crazy. I'm sure y'all got a story to tell.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Joe Exotic, and this is Sarge.
He was like a mythical character living out in the middle of bum Oklahoma, who owned 1,200 tigers and lions and bears and...
Come here, love me.
Matt spoken, good looking, love to party and have fun.
I don't think we're done blowing up today.
I don't think you are.
They have a heart and a soul and a mind. I've learned from them.
But Carol Baskin keeps saying, I can't have these tigers.
If he ever had an enemy in his life, it was Carol Baskin.
Hey, all you cool cats and kittens, it's Carol at Big Cat Rescue.
Carol is the Mother Teresa of cats.
We will end the private possession of these cats.
This is my way of living. And nobody's gonna tell me any otherwise.
Carol has an army of people working for free.
She's a plain out hypocrite. She literally does everything that I do.
So Joe says, will you go to Florida and what?
Kill that
What a story. And it got way bigger.
Sometimes they say that on the prototype for Scarface.
We're supposed to be sexy and we're luring people in.
You may now kiss the grooms.
And so there you have it. That was our trailer for The Tiger King. You can still catch it on Netflix. A lot of issues to go through there. And, you know, one of the biggest ones. But before we get into it, you know, the show is literally like Jerry Springer show that just escaped into the wild. you know, I don't know. You guys just watched the show. You guys want to give me your quick take on it before we start diving into the libertarian issues?
Crazy and nuts. Probably covers it. I mean, we'll have to talk about the individual issues, but that show was unbelievable. The amount of issues that we saw being explored there. I mean, it wasn't intentional exploration, but it was explored all the same. I mean, how many times in our lifetime are we going to hear about a zookeeper, a private zookeeper, who is a polygamist and gay? You know, it's unbelievable.
Yes, and gun-toting. You forgot about
that. And gun-toting, too, yes. Yeah.
It's that, like that saying about being the, you know, the gay gun-toting, I don't know, the bunch of things related to libertarianism and all other facets all rolled into one of political thought. And yeah, so there's a lot of stuff going on there for sure. Not to mention the other characters. Like, I got to give hands off to Carol Baskin for probably coming up with the best way to exploit her situation there compared to the others, because she seems to have rolled it into income produced from her YouTube videos and other online things, where I think she's making the most of it compared to the other people, and with the least amount, because she's got the least amount of cats too.
Well, and Tim, before you get too far into the details on Carol, let me just lay it out for the viewers.
Yeah.
Essentially, this focused on three different private zoos. There was, I can't recall the names of all of them, but the main one was focused on was one run by this character called Joe Exotic, who's the guy right. who ran as a libertarian for governor at some point. And then there was another zoo that was, can't remember whether it was in South Carolina or something. And that one was run by, the guy's name was Doc something or other, but his stuff was actually being used in Hollywood. You know, he would actually be able to get some of his animals in some movies over there. And then this gal, Carol Baskin, who ran this, place that she sort of painted as a cat refuge, although as you look into the show that there's a little bit of fuzzy history on some of that, how she evolved that. But essentially she painted herself more as an animal rescue person, and right. people could come and just view the cats that, you know, had been rescued from some of these situations. But three private zoos that had just an unbelievable amount of drama going on behind the scenes. I mean, 7 episodes, I wouldn't have been able to tell you could fit it all into, you know, I would have thought one episode would be enough to tell a story like this. And literally every moment your jaw is dropping because you can't believe the next bomb that they're dropping on the show.
Yeah, I call Carol Baskin was the crony capitalist of them all. She wanted to utilize the power of government to shut down her competition.
Exactly.
And she did a lot of things to try to make that happen. But I don't know. I've only watched 2 episodes, and I'm going to keep watching it, though. That's the really sad thing, is that I'll probably watch the rest of it.
It's like a train wreck. You just can't turn your head away.
Tim, I guess I must be really sad, because I watched the full 7 and then watched half of the of number 8.
Oh wow! Yeah, I don't know. You may want to talk to a doctor when this is over, and you can go see a doctor.
I kept finding myself during the middle of these shows wanting to say, Jerry, Jerry, from the old Jerry Springer show.
Yeah, and no Jerry Springer around. Yeah. I don't know. I think the question, if I can answer the question, is Joe a libertarian? I think that everybody's a libertarian when it comes to their own liberty. You know, everybody wants to protect that. It's what is your policy when we're referring to the liberty of other people? And I think these people are all three of them were cultists, and they had this cult following, which I assume it must be kind of a human condition for certain humans to want to be adulated. And I think there's even a book called The Cult of the Presidency, written by a really sharp guy who's also a libertarian, but The Cult of the Presidency, because, you know, it itself, the presidency is a type of cult. When you think about it, with all the adoration and so on and so forth surrounding all these presidents we've had in the past. And so, not to get off track from Joe, but so back to Joe, he's a guy that I don't think that he's too interested in mutually beneficial exchange, because nor are the other two. Because they've got people that are helping them. And I don't know, maybe it is mutually beneficial to the other people because they have no other place to go and that kind of thing. They're up against, I mean, they're not the normal type of people to become wrapped up in these cults. But a libertarian is one who is interested in mutually beneficial exchange, in, you know, free market thing. And at least to me. And so they have this idea that they will compete willingly in the marketplace to provide for their customers that which they desire. And I guess they are providing these tigers as a way of getting, they're making money and they're providing something for these other people, which is, okay, we get to pet the tigers, we get to save the tigers, we get to take pictures with the tigers, and so on. So maybe there is a little bit of mutually beneficial exchange going on there. But when it comes to their exploitation of other people, I think they go off the libertarian reservation at that point, and they exploit their employees for sure.
Well, and to give you guys a little more context, I guess, going into some of these issues, the reason this show has kind of a tie into the Libertarian Canada is about episode 5 or 6. They get to the point where the guy is, with all the other drama going on in his life, he decides to run for president as an independent, and that being unsuccessful, he decides to make a run in Oklahoma for governor as a libertarian, and he's actually running in primaries. And I actually was a little bit misinformed, I guess, by the show, or I took away the wrong idea that I thought he was in the general election, but it was actually just in the primaries that he was running as a libertarian, and then he was eliminated. He was running in a group of three and he finished third. So it wasn't, thank goodness, the Oklahoma libertarians have some sanity, but they didn't wind up electing him.
Thank God.
So it's not like he was the standard bearer for, the libertarians, but, the point is the show kind of makes a strong tie to him as a libertarian. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff going to the point where at the end of the show, and this is no spoiler, because they start the show off, the guy is in jail. Essentially, he's been convicted. Yes. He's sentenced for 22 years for a variety of crimes, including attempted murder of one of his competitors, the Carol Baskin woman that we've been talking about. And it's a very odd, strange show. There's so many libertarian issues that, hopefully we can tag along these as we go along, from the issue of endangered species, breeding big cats, how these people, operated their businesses, were they, should there be more regulation in some of these places? I mean, as you mentioned, the way they dealt with some of their employees was pretty horrific, it seemed like, and we'll get into that. And there was some issues with trademarks and copyrights that were a little bit of issue too. And that led to some of his legal troubles, as he wound up owing this Carol Baskin woman millions of dollars because of that. And then there was some issues with guns on the property, where he was pointing them just about everybody. And then there was the polygamy issue. So there's just a ton of stuff to unpack in this, and hopefully we can get through it all. But, the biggest issue is just the libertarian thing, and the fact that people might walk away with the fact that this is a libertarian, and, libertarians are all just off the rails. And as Tim was alluding to, I think a lot of us come there for a lot of different reasons, but, most of it is about, the sanctity of you own yourself, an individual property, right? And so that's I think what brings us most here. I don't know if you guys wanted to briefly give an anecdote about how you got there, but I got there discovering Milton Friedman's Free to Choose at some point, via Stossel, and And that's what really sort of clicked for me and led me on this path. I don't know if you guys wanted to share any of that about you or.
Well, when I started when I first came to the United States, I'll probably have to call myself a social democrat. That's what I probably will be. I even believed a little bit in socialism, not completely, but a little bit. But what got me thinking in terms of the libertarian point of view, it was Thomas Sowell, and then later Milton Friedman. I've read a lot of their work that brought me to this point, where I believe in liberty, where I believe in the superiority and the supremacy of individual rights. And these rights are granted by God. I know maybe some of us don't believe in God or whatever, and that kind of stuff are granted by God. And no government can or should take it away. We are sovereign entities. And also, the government should only be able to take away those rights from us with just cause. Meaning, like, for instance, our freedoms could be taken away if we commit a crime. So to me, liberty is something that we hold within us and we should hold dear and we should hold on to it and grab onto it. But the government must also never able to grant special dispensations to any group of people, right? Like they did during slavery, like they currently do through affirmative action. All those things are wrong because government shall not take our rights and they should not be given rights to special rights to anyone. So we as libertarians, when it comes to the bottom line of it, we must maintain that fact that we are sovereign entities and we shall remain so. So we should be against things like slavery. We should be against things like Jim Crow. We should be against affirmative action. We should be against, and this is a tricky issue, but I believe we should be also be against abortion, which is something we probably have to discuss at some point in time.
Sure, but that's definitely an issue for another show. Because we'll never get through it if we get into abortion. That was the one thing that didn't happen on the Tiger King.
That's true.
Well, and what about yourself?
Well, it's fun to talk with Leon. The question I would have is we should have private property rights too, so we can control our private property. What if your private property is a bunch of tigers? Can you do whatever you want with them? Can you raise them? And then once they get a little bit too big to pet and to pose for pictures with, do you have the right to kill them and dispose of them like you would a horse? Same thing. What about people that raise horses? And once the horse is too old to race or too old to pull the plow or you know, to pull the carriage with the kids in it, you know, what happens then? You certainly have the right to euthanize the horse if it's too old to be of any use to anyone. And so, you know, how does that transpose to tigers and why is it different? So on and so forth. And so these are the questions this comes up with. But to answer your question, I went through the crash of 2008 and I went through bankruptcy and the loss of my house and all kinds of stuff. And so it was a kind of a come to Jesus moment in the sense that I was wondering what just happened to me and to a bunch of other people and why. And so that led me to the Mises .org site and to reading, you know, Mises and Hayek and Rothbard and to listen to people that have predicted it, like Peter Schiff, Tom Woods, and those types of people. By the way, if you really want to show what a libertarian is like, look for boring Tom Woods and his five daughters and his one wife and his extremely conservative, doesn't smoke pot, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. If you want an example of a libertarian, look at Tom Woods.
Well, I was just thinking how opposite that was from the guy, the one of the owners, Doc, he didn't have five daughters and one wife. He had about six or seven wives.
Yeah, I don't have any daughters.
Who knows how many daughters?
Yeah, exactly. So, so anyway, when I when I looked at who had predicted it and got involved with Austrian economics and then studied that, that's when the whole thing came full circle, and the libertarian viewpoint, mainly the type that you would call a Mises view or Rothbardian view, and its relationship with war, also the war powers and that kind of thing of governments, all that kind of congealed at the moment between 2008 and about 2010. And then I just been building on it ever since.
Well, that's a, and so yeah, I guess the key takeaway here is that, you know, a lot of people come to this, you know, libertarian thought from different incidents, different walks in their lives, but a lot of it has to do, there's a lot of economics that's backing it up, a lot of how we exchange with other people. And that's, you know, that seems to be at least the theme among our group. And I know there's other people that come there for, you know, guns rights, and other people come there for, you know, other, you know, things where they're skeptical of government. But, you know, the bottom line is it's, yeah, there's a lot of rational paths to becoming a libertarian, I guess. And it's not Joe Exotic or people taking off their clothes in the middle of a speech, you know, like happened at one of the libertarian conventions.
Pot is another one that seems to bring some people into the libertarian viewpoint. It's all about the sanctity of your own body and that kind of thing. So, you know, it's all relevant for that person. Whatever brought them into it is you know, good, I think, because I, you know, I'm obviously predisposed to the libertarian point of view.
Well, let me jump in. You know, it's funny, drugs was one of the issues in there, but, you know, drugs have been sort of done to death, but there was a lot of meth heads on that show, so people, you know, missing teeth and everything else on the show. But the one of the key issues I wanted to jump into was the issue of the cats, breeding big cats. You've already started talking about it, Tim, and you know, so there's a few issues here. One, they've been called an endangered species. And one of the interesting points on the show is that there are more tigers in captivity in the United States than there are in the rest of the world, which is kind of an interesting concept. And exactly, in the wild. So, and I would assume that that probably rivals the rest of the world, but I guess, you know, that's, you know, either way, it's very significant, the idea that you've got numbers in captivity that, and there's some interesting economic issues with that as well. But there's also the issue too that, you know, these cats were being raised, that their main profitability had to do with their life as a cub and being able to essentially charge people to come and take the pictures with them and pet them. And so that was one of the biggest revenue streams for these guys on the show. And so I guess, you know, do you guys have any thoughts that you wanted to jump into on the issues of, you know, whether or not, you know, the Endangered Species Act is the best way to deal with endangered species, when clearly, you know, there's, you know, they seem to be, you know, Joe Exotic on his own seems to be, you know.
Well, since the beginning of time, species have been coming into the world at large, and they have been disappearing. The dinosaurs is the most prominent example. I do not know why now we should have a law that says that certain things are essential for our existence, like a gray wolf should not be killed, or these cats should not be killed if their useful life is over, whatever, whoever defines that. I don't know who should define that. That might be a slightly different issue. But this Endangered Species Act is nothing but the government overreaching into our lives. There are cases of ranchers in Montana, one of these states up there, where these wolves will come onto their property, kill their livestock. And if the rancher kills the wolf, he could be charged. He could be prosecuted by Fish and Wildlife. I mean, this is sort of ridiculous. So what is the point? What is the point of having a law which prevents us from keeping our livelihood going just to save some animal who is actually endangering our lives and our livelihood? But the government always reaches, find some way to reach into our lives, reach into our property, to take away those rights that we as that are sovereign to us. And they're always there to make sure that we don't have them. And whenever they grab at them, they never give them back. Because the Endangered Species Act have been on the books for so long now, and there have been many challenges to it in the court, and it still is on the books.
Leon, do you know the answer to this question? I don't know it myself. But in the example of the Montana wolves, is the Montana Fish and Game allowed to kill the wolves, but the rancher is not? Or is neither one allowed to kill the wolf?
Under certain circumstances, Fish and Game can kill them. Under certain circumstances. I don't remember exactly what the law says about that, but it is possible for them to kill it. But if the rancher kills it, he could be prosecuted. But recently there was a case where one rancher did kill a wolf, but he was not prosecuted. But even in that prosecution, the Fish and Game gently and gave him like a reward. Oh, we're not going to prosecute you. They gave him a reward for killing a wolf that was on his property, destroying his sheep. Yeah. I mean, this is ridiculous.
Go ahead, Tim.
Oh, I was just going to say, I think we see that all over the place. Again, war is a great example of when the government does things that they make it illegal for us to do. In other words, you know, we can't go, you know, hey, I got a beef with my neighbor. I think I'll go, you know, shoot that guy dead. You know, the United States has a beef with its neighbor in, you know, you name it, Germany, Japan, whatever, and they can go ahead and the rules don't apply to them. And you know, that's a whole another topic with all kinds of ins and outs and ramifications that we can't go into. But we see this often, taxation. You know, the government can take our money from us at gunpoint, literally, but we can't go do that. I can't go over to Leon's house and extort him for cash, much as I may like to, but I can't do it because, you know, I don't have the authority. But if I was the tax man from the IRS, then I could, right? So we see the same thing, you know, with this whole idea of killing, you know, something that was a threat to your own private property, whereas the fishing game and their, I guess, maybe it gets into, you know, well, we can't let everybody do everything. We got to have it centralized or something. And again, that's all part of this libertarian thought. So this brings us full circle to the tigers. What about the tigers?
Well, you know, it's funny too, and we're coming to the end of our time, but I tell you, the it comes down to an issue also, private property rights. You know, when they turn these things into a zoo and they're able to make money off of, suddenly they stop being endangered. You know, essentially, you know, the population is raising in these places where people are given property rights over these animals. And I remember the economist Walter Williams used to talk about that, where he'd say, you know, what's the difference between a cow and one of the old buffaloes? You know, well, you know, nobody owned the buffaloes, so, you know, nobody had a problem, you know, really just, you know, shooting them or getting them if they were causing them trouble. But right. the cows, if you shot somebody's cow, they're coming after you. And that. You know, and of course, we have no shortage of cows. But anyways, I think that runs out our time here for this episode. And maybe we'll get back to some more of these issues on another episode. We're really amazed we didn't get through, you know, tip of the iceberg on this show. But thanks so much, all of you, for joining us for Libertarian Counterpoint. And we look forward to you're joining us on the future episodes. You can catch this show at Facebook, Libertarian Counterpoint page on Facebook, or YouTube, or the public access in Sacramento. Thanks so much.